Okay, so technique is going, so we should start. Tonight this is going to be a little mixture of languages. Actually, the idea of this conference is that it's bilingual, and from tomorrow on we will have simultaneous translation, but honestly we couldn't afford this for 2 days. So tonight I will make an introduction in English, then the lecture of Philip Oswald will be in German, and the performance of Maria Salgado is multilingual in a certain way. So, yeah, just for you who have not been in the tour, very short again, the main points of the project 50 years after 50 years of the Bauhaus, which is the greater framework of that conference. On May 4, 1968, one day after students in Paris had occupied the University of Sorbonne and announced the so-called May 68, the exhibition 50 Years of the Bauhaus was opened at the Württembergischer Kunstverein in Stuttgart. The opening was accompanied by protests against the planned closure of the Hochschule für Gestaltung Ulm, which was founded in 1953 as a successor to the Bauhaus project. Designed by Herbert Bayer and conceived by Hans-Maria Wingler, Ludwig Grote and the Kunstverein's director at that time, Dieter Honisch, the exhibition was shown in 8 additional museums worldwide until 1971. To this day, it is considered one of the most important post-war exhibitions on the Bauhaus and was of the highest significance in terms of cultural policy for the still young Federal Republic. Since at stake was not least the rehabilitation at international levels of Germany as a cultural nation in the aftermath of National Socialism. 50 years after the opening of 50 years of the Bauhaus, the Württembergischer Kunstverein is undertaking a critical rereading of this exhibition. The rereading takes as its point of departure the social, political, and artistic upheavals of the 1960s and considers the Bauhaus, its historical context, and the histories of its reception from today's perspectives. The rereading was based on the following thoughts and observations, which are mirrored both by the exhibition and also by the conference. So one point is that this exhibition was dedicated, that already the catalog says, it was dedicated to Walter Gropius, and one can say that it also represented very much Walter Gropius' perception of the Bauhaus. It was part of something we could call today the Bauhaus might or even the brand, and I don't refer to the shop, but to the Bauhaus also as a brand. And it is Philip Oswald who tonight will start on this and talk about this aspect. Then, because this exhibition was in the 60s and it was parallel to these student movements, what was interesting for us is that in Germany, these student revolts were very much related to also to the question what happened actually in the Third Reich. So they were starting to ask their parents what they had done during the Third Reich, and that's something which, of course, the 68 exhibition did not ask in terms of the people of Bauhaus, especially those who stayed in Germany, what have they done? But this is something which, especially in the 1990s, started to be a subject. So, and one figure who is quite representative for a certain ambivalence of ideological context of the Bauhaus is Herbert Bayer. And as he was the designer of our 68 exhibition, he and also the whole subject of the ambivalence between modernity and totalitarianism, to say it on a broader level, has been something which is very interesting, or which was very important for our exhibition. And Patrick Rössler tomorrow will focus on this subject, especially in regards to Herbert Bayer and his work for the Dorland Company. Then another important point, because we are having this 68 as a sort of core of our project, is that we were dealing with the radical artistic movements from the early post-war era to the 1970s. Here, especially figures like Asger Jorn or artistic groups like the Lettrists, the International Movement for an Imaginist Bauhaus, or the Situationist, etc. So this is one another big aspect of the exhibition, how this is related to the Bauhaus, probably or not. And we will have Axel Heil tomorrow, who especially will deal with Asger Jorn and his role in between of, let's say, Bauhaus, the Hochschule für Gestaltung Ulm, and the Situationists. Then another aspect of the exhibition, especially here, is about the relationships between avant-garde and the military-industrial complex, where I said it in the tour, where a figure, a Bauhaus figure like Ernst Neufert and his work on the rationalization of building processes was very important. And someone who will talk tomorrow or will start from this context is John Barker, who also presents a work in this exhibition. And he will, he's referring also in this work to the military context of Bauhaus, but what he's talking basically tomorrow about are also the relationship between the Bauhaus of the 1920s and the principles of scientific management as proposed by Frederick Winslow Taylor. This will be tomorrow. Then what we were looking at very, very briefly today is the fourth part of our exhibition, which tries to give an outlook on something we would call multiple modernisms. So the fact that from today on, and maybe starting with the 60s and the decolonization processes which started then, and of course the globalization developments since the 90s, since 89, so that we from today perspective must reread and reread and reread modernity from a global perspective again and again. And in this exhibition we can do this really on some smaller examples, but somebody who has worked on an exhibition is Mariel van Oosten, and who will tomorrow also talk about this, about the Bauhaus from a transcultural and more global perspective. From the very beginning it was, so for those who were in my tour, I'm repeating a bit, so from the very beginning it was clear to us that this Bauhaus exhibition is not going to present furniture or something like this from the Bauhaus, but we were very happy when we found this work from Helmut Heisenbüttel, who is performing his poem, The Man Who Became Lesbian, based on a gender-disturbing sort of wordplay. And he's doing that sitting on the most iconic furniture of the Bauhaus, probably Marcel Breuer's Vasili chair. And tonight, Maria Salgada, who reworked this work by Helmut Heisenbüttel, will show her performance at 8. What we open with Heisenbüttel and also the work actually from John Barker is a certain questioning of gender roles, which in a much more professional and deeper sense was and worked on by Mona Mahal and Asli Serbest in these table installations you see in the exhibition and also in other objects which you can follow throughout the whole exhibition. So in the lecture performance tomorrow, they will focus on this context. And last not least, there is actually in the program Ines Dujak, but who wanted to present a film, but as far as I learned, it has not been ready. So she will be present tomorrow and she will discuss with us. There is also a panel. So this will be her role tomorrow. So, jetzt switche ich mal kurz auf Deutsch, also weil es ja gleich auch auf Deutsch weitergeht. Also heute eben Philipp Ostwald als nächstes, den ich kurz vorstellen möchte. Philipp Ostwald ist Architekt und Publizist in Berlin, seit 2006 Professor für Architekturtheorie und Entwurf an der Universität Kassel. Von 1988 bis 1994 war er Redakteur der Architekturzeitschrift Arch Plus, von 1996 bis 1997 Mitarbeiter im Büro OMA von Rem Koolhaas. 1998 gewann er den ersten Preis im Wettbewerb für das ehemalige Frauen-KZ Ravensbrück, gemeinsam mit Stefan Tischer und Stefanie Ostwald, das auch im Anschluss in Teilen realisiert wurde. Von 2000 bis 2002 war er Gastprofessor an der Brandenburgischen Technischen Universität in Cottbus und später Co-Leiter des europäischen Forschungsprojektes Urban Catalyst. 2004 war er Mitinitiator und Co-Kurator der kulturellen Zwischennutzung des Palast der Republik in Berlin und 2002 bis 2008 Leiter des Projektes Shrinking Cities oder Schrumpfende Städte der Kulturstiftung des Bundes. Er war von 2009 bis 2014, wie Sie sicher wissen, Direktor der Stiftung Bauhaus Dessau und Associated Investigator am Exzellenzmuster Bildwissen Gestaltung der Humboldt-Universität Berlin. Seit 2012 ist er Mitinitiator des Projektes von Projekt Bauhaus 2012. Er ist Autor und Herausgeber zahlreicher Publikationen zur zeitgenössischen Architektur und Stadtentwicklung. Bevor ich ihm jetzt die Bühne hier überlasse, auch kurz ein paar Worte zu Maria Salgado. Maria Salgado ist Lyrikerin und Sprachforscherin, arbeitet als Lyrikdozentin und freiberufliche Schriftstellerin. 2014 promovierte sie in Literaturtheorie und Komparatistik an der Universidad Autónoma de Madrid mit einer Dissertation über spanische experimentelle und innovative Lyrik seit 1964. Salgado arbeitet mit Sprache als Ausgangsmaterial von Texten, Audiotexten und Performances. Sie ist Mitglied und Mitbegründerin des unabhängigen Forschungsseminars zum Thema Sprache und Krise mit dem Namen Seminario Euraca. Salgado veröffentlichte 4 Gedichtsbände in Spanien und führte ihre Performances in Europa, unter anderem auch in Stuttgart, sowie in Süd- und Nordamerika auf. Sie arbeitet mit dem zeitgenössischen Komponisten Fran M.M. Cabeza de Vaca am interdisziplinären Projekt Audiotext, das sich mit der Frage beschäftigt, wie man Sprachklänge und musikalische Klänge hör- und sichtbar machen kann. Ihr jüngstes Projekt, außer das Heißenbüttel-Projekt, was ja heute Weltpremiere hat, also ihr jüngstes Projekt Trinete Ultimo Reino, wenn ich das irgendwie richtig ausspreche, handelt von der Beziehung zwischen Ungehorsam und Queerness. 2017 bis 2018 war sie Stipendiatin an der Akademie Schloss Solitude im Rahmen einer Kooperation mit dem Fachbereich Intermediales Gestalten der Staatlichen Akademie der Künste in Stuttgart. Und bevor ich fast hier den Platz räume, will ich auch noch mal Danke sagen. Natürlich hier schon mal Danke, auch wenn wir noch am Anfang singen, an alle Referenten und Referentinnen, die angereist sind und ich mich schon sehr, sehr auf alle Beiträge freue und sehr neugierig bin. Danke auch an das Team des WKVs, die, also auch, weil wir haben ja bald schon Ende dieser Ausstellung, das ist das Schockierende, ab Ende nächster Woche ist vorbei. Also kann ich eigentlich auch nochmal Dankeschön für die gesamte Ausstellung sagen, aber natürlich auch für die Vorbereitung jetzt hier zu der Konferenz. Also vielen Dank an das gesamte Team und vor allem an Silke Albrecht, Barbara Mocco und Nathalie Storelli. Dank auch an die Förderer, den nochmal von Ausstellung und Konferenz. Das sind die Kulturstiftung des Bundes, das Ministerium für Wissenschaft, Forschung und Kunst des Landes Baden-Württemberg, das Kulturamt der Stadt Stuttgart, der Sparkassenverband Baden-Württemberg und die Wüstenrot-Stiftung. Und jemand, jetzt weiß ich gar nicht, ob sie da ist. Achso, somebody I really, it, shortly switch to English, somebody I really like to welcome very deeply and also thank is Julia Percev from Budapest, who was an intern in 2013, and she started to work on our Bauhaus archives, millions and millions of files where she was making the dates, the names, and this was an very, and at that time we didn't really know that we are going to make this exhibition, but it was a very, very, very important source. So I'm happy that finally, almost at the end of the exhibition, we can thank you very much. So, und bevor es jetzt ganz wirklich losgeht, einen habe ich noch. From somebody like Alexander Kluge, but also Ines Dujak, I learned that during conference, sometimes music is very important. So I'm going to show a very short music clip, which is also part of the exhibition, which is not really clear what it all has to do with Bauhaus, but maybe yes, maybe no. But definitely it is something which is related to that moment where this exhibition was shown in Stuttgart. And it's a little music clip from Le Groupe mit Wedkin called Rodia 448. Just very, very briefly, the background of this piece. So in 1967, this textile factory, Rodia Seta, was under strike, and one can say it was the kind of pre-strike for May 68. So it was a very important strike where a lot of solidarity also came from the students, and which was very special on this strike is that it was not only about better working conditions, but also about better living conditions. So the idea of cultural participation. This is why they invited in 67 Chris Marker, who made a film about this strike, and then he led all his technical equipment there. And through this Le Groupe mit Wedkin was founded. And they made this, in 68, this film, which is some minutes, it's not very, well, it's 4 minutes.
The bains c'est fini maintenant. Nos ouvriers ont du temps. À 4 heures le matin, je puis admirer les étoiles. Je travaille en 4-8 à la Rodia Seta. Mardi, mercredi, 4h-12h. Jeudi, vendredi, 12h-20h. Samedi, dimanche, lundi, 20h-4h. Jusqu'au jeudi matin, juste le temps d'effacer la fatigue, pour retourner au travail plein de montagnes. Merci, gros poulain, trust de la chimie, premier groupe financier français. C'est grâce à toi qu'on peut s'embourgeoiser. Un dimanche sur quatre toute l'année, à la Rodia Seta. Merci, gros poulain, trust de la chimie, baptisé nos usines avec des noms. De vingt capitaux, Lyon, Metz, Gorge de Loup, Belle Étoile, Saint-Fond, Péage de Roussillon, et derrière les hauts murs de la rivière Seta, dans des locaux fermés. Éclairé au néon, la lumière la plus proche de celle du soleil, comme dit le patron. On travaille en
l'appel continue. À plus de 30 degrés et 70% d'humidité, on devient tous nerveux. Nos ulcères.